are in the perfect neighborhood for talking about Jane Jacobs because we live in a very beautiful, pristine, low-rise, intimate setting. And Jane Jacobs believed that neighborhoods the best kind of neighborhoods had an exuberant diversity, which meant an incredibly wonderful mix of people. And stevedores were friends with teachers who were friends with the puppeteers. And it used to be that way in Brooklyn. And today in Brooklyn Heights, we have squash players who went to Middlebury who are lawyers living next door to bankers who play tennis at Yale. And everybody manages to make it work, overcoming those vast differences, which is terrific. But of course, Brownstone Brooklyn in particular is always now listed at, on the top of in some of the most expensive places to live on earth. And one of the reasons, of course, is because it's beautiful, it's low rise, it's intimate. And so I guess I want to start with a kind of devil's advocate question. As we deify Jacobs, is it really in this moment of housing crisis, rising rates of homelessness, is it morally justifiable to really still celebrate her? And would she actually have been committed to some of the things she was committed to today in this environment? Again, when Jacobs was writing, people were fleeing cities. There was the whole, there was white flight and exodus, and not some of the problems we face today in terms of simply hideously expensive housing. So who wants to take that on first?
I'm pointing at him.
Looks like it's in my place. Well, I think it's legitimate to think about the problem of Jane Jacobs as an urban icon in a period in which cities are becoming more prosperous, and thinking about how she was, as you said, an icon of, and really had her career begin in a time when cities were evacuating of capital and of people of certain kinds, white people mostly, and middle class people largely. And so today, but what we have today is something that she did identify back in that time is the same thing that's sort of still happening, which is inequality in cities, just in different patterns. And so I think it's important to think about Jacobs as someone who did think about inequality in cities, just not in all the ways that we might think about it today. And so I do think there are ways that we can use Jacobs's ideas about what the good city is and what the most fruitful way to live in cities is to try to renew some of our ideas about city living today and to try to make cities work for all. And I think most explicitly that would be not to so much think about her, the way that she thought about cities as their physical environment or their built environment, right? We often think about Jacobs as the deity of the dense neighborhood, right, and I think that's right. True. It's certainly obviously there. It's the part that draws people into Death and Life of Great American Cities. It's the part that makes her so powerfully resonant for people when they see the life they want to live in cities described.
Right.
But I think what we need to think about her as an economic thinker, as someone who thinks about what it is that makes cities the most powerful generators of economic diversity. Right, that's the diversity that really mattered to her, was economic diversity that then could make for social diversity. And so she asked her readers over her long career of writing, beyond, before and after Death and Life, to think about the ways that you could generate economic diversity from the ground up and to make it work for all kinds of citizens, for people of all kinds, across all kinds of socioeconomic and racial lines and all kinds of lines together. That's, I think, the great strength. Now, that theme in her writing is not always the one that we remember the most, and it's most right. present in the books that are not Death and Life of Great American
Which is
cities.
The only so one, you know, which is the one that right. everyone reads, and most people couldn't right. name the other, I think there's seven, right?
Something like that, yeah. It depends what you count as a book and not in many of her writings. But it's there in Death and Life, too, largely in the second half of Death and Life, also the least read part of Death and Life. It's a long book, but it's worth soldiering through to the second half for that message, which is a complicated one and one that sort of delves into the details and some of her ideas about economic policy and things like that, about how to generate self-regenerating economies from below at the sort of ground level as engines of diverse kinds of city life.
Which we do. There's a lot of emphasis on that kind of thing today. And one thing we were talking about when we all met is that, there's a lot of emphasis on her conflict with Moses, which this movie, this film just tells really, really beautifully. But she had these really interesting conflicts with other huge, you know, colossal figures of the 20th century. And one of the, I'm fascinated by two of them. One is the rivalry, the antipathy really she had for Le Corbusier, who was the progenitor really of the high-rise housing project, the urban renewal movement. And in a sense, to me, they're the same, they're different versions of the same creature, because they're trying to solve the problems of cities really through the lens of design, right? Not through some of the other kinds of social forces we might think about, job creation, poverty amelioration. So what, you know, how do you come down on that? I mean, she obviously hated him. She thought that high-rise projects, the problem with them was that they were ugly, that they cut off, disrupted the street grid, that people would be isolated. And of course, you know, many housing projects in other cities failed. New York City today has a population in our housing authority, 400 to 600,000 people, basically the size of Las Vegas, so it's not a failure. And especially when she was writing in the 50s, it was a time when housing projects were a wonderful agent of social mobility. You had people like Joel Klein and Lloyd Blankfein and growing up in them. So why wouldn't, I know this is an obsession of Rob's as well.
I think it would be worth, I want to go really talk about Corbusier, but in terms of the success, they were sometimes a success for the people living there, but they were definitely not a success for the people that were displaced to create them. And I think that would be worthwhile coming back to that. But on the Corbusier, that's what first interested me, was when I heard Matt talk about the real battle was between Jane and Corbusier, or Corbusier's idea. Because I think the reason that this doing this movie was interesting to me was not just the historical story of it, but its implications today. And to me, that's where you see Corbusier winning in China and India. You know, if you look at the pictures of what they're envisioning, it's all sort of sexy visions, you know, and that's what the difference between sort of the sexy renderings and it's, you know, Matt and I share an interest in design. You know, it's not that there, it's not about sort of this high design. It's what happens when that actually gets executed. And so it's harder to do that. It doesn't make, I think one of the things Matt can talk about is in the midst of a movie, it's a more complicated.
Absolutely.
But one of the things that I think Matt has done in the movie is also, when you see people, it's like, why would anyone build, these buildings don't look great, or these buildings, it doesn't make sense. But if you hear, you know, the idea of light and air, and you talk about, when you talk about people living in them, they did have successful pieces.
Matt?
Well, I think it's a lot of complications here. The Corbusian model, which started as a relatively socialistic idea in Europe before the Second World War, was meant to solve a lot of problems that had evolved in cities after the Industrial Revolution. They were very real problems, and Corbusier had the sexiest drawings imaginable. I mean, he was the greatest marketer of all time. And then, you know, he was also very pliable. He wanted to work for Stalin, and when Stalin turned him down, he wrote a letter to Hitler. So he was that type of architect, which is like most of them. But I think Philip Johnson, Mies van der Rohe's less is more, and Philip Johnson's adage was, I'm a whore. So then this strange thing happens, which we cover in the movie, Paul Goldberger and Bob Stern walk us through it, is that all these Corbusian drawings jumped the pond, as it were, after World War II. Really, before the war, the 39 World's Fair, when GM had this thing called the Futurama, which is the greatest diorama ever built by Mr. Bel Geddes. It was the great marketing thing by GM to show you that highways were essential to all of our lives. Then World War II happened, and things were put on hold, and then they realized this vision, which was very much the Corbusian idea, but it became perverted. Corbusier wasn't here to oversee it. In fact, he was very much marginalized and ended up hating the United States and spoke against it. every chance he had, because they weren't hiring him. They were basically stealing his ideas. And they were also misinterpreting them and misimplementing them. Not to say that what he planned was perfect, and I think there were a lot of imperfections in what he did. But I think this is bringing to my point, which is something I think that Jacobs was put her finger on very early, which is that collusion of money and governments stealing money and appropriating it among fat cats, basically. Think of Monopoly when you think of this for your imagery, is what really sent things off in a wrong direction. And what a lot of the urban renewal, which was built along what are called Corbusian lines, were projects that were basically plundered by real estate developers colluding with governments, and people were getting rich, and the end users of these schemes were frequently not getting a good bargain, on top of the fact that there was an enormous amount of displacement of populations and enormous disruption of urban fabric and an enormous uprooting of social capital, which is what Jacobs, I think, is primarily interested in. So Sam probably has a lot to say about this too, but I think that these are really the themes that she's getting at. So it's very complicated. I think a great way to think of it that's very contemporary in the nightmare era of Trump that we're all living in the movie that we've made, which we intended to be live in a Hillary world, is living in a Trump world. But Robert Moses looks like he has an orange wig on to you in this film. I mean, he's so Trump. It's extraordinary.
Well, but he always thinks he's right. He's never wrong.
And he just says the most appalling things, which people, you just don't think of people doing in that period, but he really does say them on film, much to our pleasure, because the archival of him is unbelievable. But that sulfuric smell you get when you... have a lot of government money and a lot of capital trading hands, and poor people really are just a vague idea about who will live in these smallish apartments that the people building them would never dream of living in, I think is a problem. I'm oversimplifying it, but I'm talking about collusion, and I'm talking about destruction of social capital, and I'm talking about a term that a sociologist and psychiatrist named Mindy Fully Love, who's in our movie, talks about, and she calls it root shock, which is the the uprooting of populations in the name of progress and urban renewal, which causes huge disruptions in social capital. This is what Jacobs put her finger on very early. You have to remember, she's identifying this in the 50s when urban renewal did not have a negative connotation. It was a very sexy idea that was exemplified by, again, the great marketing renderings of Corbusier and all the people that were her followers at the time.
And who's recently brought up urban renewal?
Donald Trump. Mentioned urban renewal. Of course, he doesn't know what it means at all.
But he wants it to scare people.
Yeah. No, I think he wants to do infrastructure deals with his buddies, frankly.
Right.
Which is what I'm talking about with collusion.
Well, and he wants us to believe that cities are gang-plagued hellholes also.
Yeah, all this stuff, I think... this stuff resonates when you see the film, which I hope you will. I think that he's obviously, he demagogues everything, so he's demagoguing this. But you have this bizarre thing where this person's talking about a world that is really an urban world that was very much in our past, really from his childhood, or his young adulthood, which is why he's kind of bringing it up. But I believe that he's also obsessed with plundering the federal dollars that will be allotted to infrastructure and allocating it to his friends, which is what Jacobs identifies in the book, and she fingers Moses and a lot of other people, not just specifically Moses. I think we're bizarrely on the precipice of a reboot of that, which is one use, I hope, for the film to educate people about this circumstance and make them aware that the Democrats, Chuck Schumer, saying we can work with him on infrastructure, but if you know the real story, I think this is really, there are a lot of danger signs ahead.
Well, we should be clear here, right? We've already been through it. And that was the 80s. That's why there's Trump's name on a bunch of buildings from the 1980s in New York City. I mean, the legacy of urban renewal is the the political economic form in which we continue to do development today in big cities like New York City, which is the public-private form of various forms of public-private. You can call it collusion. In some ways it is. When it gets corrupt, it becomes collusion. You might argue, and Jacobs would have argued, that at the heart of this there was collusion, that you needed to have that to make it work, and that's why it was corrupt and bankrupt. But I do think that there's a difference between someone like Moses and who in my household we call the regime figurehead, which is that I think Moses had a vision of the social good. And that vision was a connected metropolis through a network of highways and a sort of renewed cityscape at the heart of it, and a kind of continuation of the industrial vision of planners and other folks who believed in separating out of the uses in the cityscape and making a healthy city work that way. The way he wanted to get there, however, ended up underwriting all the very things you talk about, and especially the root shock that Mindy Fulop has discussed and the loss of social capital that Jacobs discussed. And I think we're still working our way out of the long legacy of this long campaign of modernization, which transformed so many parts of our economies and our social lives across the globe, right, in ways in which we envisioned progress and growth as the ways to run a society. And it's hard to imagine how else you would have run a society coming out of a moment of industrialization. And now we have to reimagine that. We have to reimagine it through models of sustainability and resiliency that both support millions and billions of people on a planet in danger of climate change. And it has to be something that continues to keep economies going, but not imagining them as something that is always growing and growing and growing. And this is why I think Jacobs is a really useful thinker for us these days, because she can help us to imagine ways to organize the economy that move money around to as many people as possible, but don't rest upon these massive transformation schemes that uproot people's lives and require some people to sacrifice in the name of progress while other people benefit. Or at least that's the hope. Now, we don't know where her ideas would lead other than that they give us a nugget of hope on that front.
Right.
Very well put.
I want to move to the race issue. Jane Jacobs famously did not deal with race in Death and Life. And when her editor, Jason Epstein, said, you know, sent her some notes on a first draft and said, you should really, you know, we need to talk about race. Again, this is... we're talking about several, you know, coming right out of Brown versus Board of Education. And she responds to him, you know, don't even cherish the hope. You know, she doesn't want to do it. And of course, racial tensions, Black Lives Matter is so much of what animates some of the problems we're dealing with today. And, you know, she got something hugely wrong that we don't tend to really talk about very much. And I wanted to know what motivated her to why did she have that blind spot?
I don't quite see it as a blind spot or as something hugely wrong. I think there's a way to look at it somewhat differently. Epstein, there's a letter to from Jason Epstein to Jacobs saying, I really think you should address the Negro question
right. In
the book, which is what they were calling it then, and has been dated like such a term that's dated into oblivion now, luckily. So he's saying, write about African Americans, and she's basically saying to him, I haven't read the full text of the letters, but I've read summaries of them. No, I don't want to do it. I want to write about it from a more universalist perspective. I don't want to specifically write a book about race because I'm writing a book about the form of cities and the function of cities. So I think she does address, first of all, she writes extensively about East Harlem.
Right, and we should say that, I mean, she's introduced to the whole idea, right, through William Kirk at Union Settlement.
And first
encounters the kind of horrors of...
Yeah, I think there's an argument to say that she's sort of colorblind because she's going to lots of different areas of several different cities that are considered to be blighted and are being labeled as slums. And one of her great contributions is that the slum is the S word. Slum is in the eye of the beholder. A lot of these neighborhoods were actually very functional, vital neighborhoods, but they were being called, labeled slums by people who had political agendas. If you know what East Harlem was all about then, she writes extensively about it, and she goes there, and that's really where the light bulb went off, and she saw that all of this federal urban renewal money was actually making things worse, and the people that clued her into that were people working in the settlement houses there who really knew the neighborhood and brought her around and saw that. So she's writing about African Americans who are very displeased by the public housing that they're living in, and a lot of the things they're saying basically are matters of social capital, saying that there's no longer the laundromat in the grocery store, there's no one to borrow 5 cents from, and then one of the famous passages of the book, she says, a lot of the residents of one of the projects were very mad at the lawn, and they were saying, why are you so mad at this patch of grass? And she quotes a resident, it's a largely African-American housing project, of saying, because the fat cats come here and they say, oh, now the poor have everything because they have a pristine green lawn. And what she's trying to say is, like, they've taken everything away from us. This was her point. And she does, in that section, say that African Americans are the most discriminated against people and the most victimized by urban renewal. But she doesn't address race far beyond that. I see it as, in a way, like the first Obama presidential campaign. Obama didn't talk about race, really. He was running as not the racial candidate, not the black candidate. He was running as a presidential candidate, which I think was a successful thing to do in a universalist approach that addresses things from a universalist perspective and not trying to particularize it. I think that's the best way to look at it, and I can accept that. I think that that's what she intended. I think she's open to criticism, certainly, and certainly from our lens looking backwards, it's almost unthinkable.
Right.
But this was pre-60s, it was post-Brown, I agree. But I think there's a different way to look at it. I've talked to African-American scholars who, some of them are totally fine with her and think she's got it, and there are people that do vehemently disagree.
I mean, but that also, I don't think any of us are saying this is not meant to be a Saint Jane. No, I think I don't think she says she does not have all the answers. And one of my favorite, talked to someone who knew her and who went to her in Toronto after a tragedy, I think it was in New Orleans, and said, you know, what should we do? And she said, New Orleans needs to look around. It's not about someone coming in or bringing her, you know, they were asking, what of your remedies would you sort of bring in?
And, well, she believed everything had to organically arise.
Yeah, and to look, I mean, her message to us is look around our cities and come up with the answers that are applicable now. I mean, I think some of the things work for us now, but I think, as you pointed out, we're operating, especially in New York and San Francisco, in over-success drive. We have a whole different set of problems that I think a lot of the things that we think of as the Jane Jacobs answers aren't going to necessarily work, and I don't think she would have applied.
She wouldn't have thought, right, they would have worked.
She had an analysis of the way that forces constructed cities that, for her, were more primary than the problem of race. And it resulted in problems that were just she could see as racial inequality. She's one of the first writers to a large public audience. She's not the first, but one of the first to identify what we call redlining. She called it credit blacklisting in Death and Life and in some articles she wrote before that. There were other writers, particularly her friend in The Village, why does his name just go out
Gans?
Of my head? No, well, Herbert Gans wrote about these things in the abstract, but... we leave it. But there were other writers that were writing about these things. But I think the reason that she sort of leaves it out as a primary driving force is in part because, as you said, Matt, she sees herself as a universalist and does not want to be a particularist. She does not want to be drawn into a set of debates during the 1960s, late 50s and 1960s, as you put it, about the Negro problem, right? Which was a series of debates mostly held by sociologists about the behavior of particular groups of people. And I think she recognized quite rightly that that was an odious kind of way to talk about groups of people, right? She didn't want to be drawn in to this set of conversations that sociologists like Herbert Gans, and this is who was spurring Jason Epstein to ask her about this, was Herbert Gans and another of the sociologists, Nathan Glazer, right, who had been Daniel Patrick Moynihan's co-author on Beyond the Melting Pot, which was about these problems. And this was a sort of very complex debate, which we don't need to get into now, but which was about the properties of particular groups of people in the city and whether they were beneficial or not. And it led to all kinds of problems that we have about all the sort of long history of thinking about welfare and all that sort of thing. And I think she did not want to be drawn into that kind of discussion.
And housing projects, because there's a belief that the problem with the projects isn't designed, but the people who are living there, as the film talked about.
Right, she had no interest in talking about it that way. She wanted to say, no, these are a problem simply because of the way they create these residential monocultures. They wipe away the landscape that all kinds of people use to construct lives on the ground of their own making. All people are capable of this, and that was her universalist way of doing this. But I do think that she didn't quite think hard enough or in long term enough about the problem of race as a structuring phenomenon in urban life, and that's in part because she was obsessed with this modernization problem, this problem of top-down power shaping cities, and that prevented her from seeing, in some ways, the longer history of the way that race and class were already structuring cities in the private sector long before public agencies got really involved in shaping cities and took up some of those class and race-based inequalities and shaped them into the landscape with public housing, with urban renewal. Those of us who spend our lives reading urban history have had to read over and over again many times. And I should also say, chapter 7 and 8 of Manhattan Projects deal quite in depth with the story of East Harlem and Jacobson.
Well, one thing I wanted to ask you, I mean, did she ever come around to the conventional liberal position that, you know, part of the failure of the public housing system was the federal divestment, you know, was white flight, and followed by federal divestment? Or did she really believe it was that these organic structures were devastated?
I think she would have said that's a distraction, right?
Right.
Which I think is wrong in some sense, in the sense that we know now, looking back at the history, that there was a lot of money. Declining amounts of money over the 1940s and 50s and into the 60s were made for constructing public housing. Very little was put forward for maintenance in public housing.
Right.
But I think that she would have said that's sort of a problem that we shouldn't even have to grapple with, because we shouldn't be making these places in the first place. We should be finding more organic bottom up ways to help people plan their own ideas about low income housing and ways to do that, which is what she tried to do in Toronto when she moved there. She supported various community groups who wanted to build sort of organic community based. Public low-income housing projects that were not on that modernist kind of tower in the park vision.
I want to also talk about, and to get back to the rivalries issue, and she had, of course, a rivalry with Lewis Mumford, the architectural critic at The New Yorker, who had supported her work early on, had been a champion, and then did a lengthy, legendary review of Death and Life that I think is 10,000 words in 1962. We waited a year, right, worked on it for a very long time, because it came out a year after the book was published, and it had the unfortunate title Mother Jacob's Home Remedies, which you know, made it to seem that he was completely anti-woman.
I think he was pretty anti-woman. He also refers to her schoolgirl.
Right. Yeah. There's
theories,
lots of derisive, horrible things. But there, you know, there's one point that I was struck by is that he really says, you know, the focus, the whole eyes on the street concept. We're watching each other. We have our eye on each other's children. We're making soup for the elderly neighbor during the snowstorm upstairs. Is really the way we're going to keep ourselves safe. And then Mumford argues that if her vision is so grounded in crime prevention that it really can't be considered much of a vision at all, because it's somewhat monofocused. And I wanted to know where you guys stand on that.
As the defender of all things Joan of Arc, yeah. Jane Jacobs.
And why he turned on her. We can talk about why he turned on her, which is just interesting psychologically.
Yeah, I don't know. It's unclear. I don't think she was quite clear why he turned on her. Maybe jealous. Mm-hmm. He won the National Book Award that year, however.
Right.
She was the runner-up. So,
but was she? Would you think he was surprised by her sort of attack on his thinking?
Yeah, well, he was a worshiper of the Garden City.
Right.
And she wanted something a little more dense. Because
she thought the Garden City also disrupted, right, was too choreographed.
I think that it was very planned, and very planned by someone who was not the user of the city. At first she loved all these things, by the way. This is something very interesting about her, is that she had the zeal of the converted, because she was a journalist who covered all of these things for years. And as a recovering journalist, I can tell you, you tend to drink the Kool-Aid of the people you're covering. And she was covering an industry which was architecture, design, and urban renewal. And she admits she was in cozy with all those people, because to cultivate sources, you've got to, they get wined and dined, and she was susceptible to it. And then, this is, I think, the interesting thing about her and what makes her so brilliant, is that it's not many a journalist who actually looks deep enough into the material that they're covering to say, wait a minute, this is a cart of bullshit. And she turned, and that's what Death and Life is. It's really a renunciation, in large part, of this industry, that this kind of like architectural industrial complex that she was one of the primary coverers of as an associate editor of Architectural Forum, which is the biggest deal magazine at the time. Mumford worshipped Ebenezer Howard and all these obscure people who brought us the Garden City, which can be leafy, wonderful places, but Jacobs really thought were dull and unvital. She spent a lot of time pushing back on Mumford's pet ideas and concepts, and really started saying, and this at the time was very unfashionable, because as white flight was happening in the city, was thought to be a bad place, an evil place, and she was celebrating the kind of nasty sidewalk of Hudson Street, which, if you look at the photos of it then, was a kind of dirty, nasty-looking little street. It wasn't what we think of it today. And these were kind of radical thoughts at the time. And she does this very captivating thing. And this is where Corbeau and Jacobs are interesting, is they were actually great at putting out a simple, graspable idea that has become immortal, really. That's a wonderful way to look at them both. The Ballet of the Street, which is the most famous passage of the book, celebrates this Hudson Street, 555 Hudson's, where she lived. You can go look at the house today. And it's just a wonderful piece of writing that's very evocative, and it celebrates this. Now, she has been slammed over the years for saying, even in her time, saying, well, the world cannot be Greenwich Village. And at the time, there was a lot of pushback from her side. And I think one of her defenders, I can't remember who at the time, maybe you'll remember, said, she's not saying the world should be Greenwich Village. She's saying that Greenwich Village is a great for instance. And I think that's a defensible thing to say.
That was really her way of looking at things, was to go out and find these models of places that she thought were really working, and then try to extrapolate larger larger patterns, larger lessons from them that could be applied to thinking and to going forward in making cities in the future. Yeah. There's a great scene sort of in the Jacobs story that I don't know if you were able to get into your film in a way, but that really illustrates this transformation that she went through, which is when she's visiting Philadelphia and she's being escorted around by one of the people she cultivated, her source, which is a planner in Philadelphia in those years, by the name of Edmund Bacon, who was a huge deal in Philadelphia in those years, and one of the great sort of giants of modern urban planning, and she was quite sympathetic to his ideas about how they might renovate Philadelphia and all the projects that urban renewal projects that were going forward, replanning projects, and Bacon had taken her to one street where they were planning an urban renewal project, and it was a series of row houses and a lot of people playing on the street and doing things and hanging out in the street. Then they went around the corner to a place that had to one of the plazas where the new housing had been built, and he said, look how great it is. And she noticed, despite the fact that she had been a supporter of these things, she had written positively about these ideas, something hit her wrong about these two vistas. One was a street of vitality, and one was a street of openness and nothingness, right? A sort of a blank.
There's an image of a lone little boy kicking a tire exactly. with no one to play.
Well, but didn't she ask them, why aren't anybody using it? And they said, well, people aren't using it the way that they should be using it.
Specifically, they said, people are stupid. Yeah, right. They don't know how to. And then this is another light bulb going off moment. That's what she turned on, though.
Yeah, that's the kind of thing that really stuck in her craw, right? And that was the sort of thing that I think she also thought, going back to Mumford, about Mumford, was that he was the sort of person who thought he knew better than what he knew what people should be doing. He knew, knew how they should live, right? They should live in decentralized garden communities on the outskirts of city, because cities had clearly failed. They had become what he called the necropolis, right? They had become the great casualties of the age of industrialization. And he was building on some as a number of you suggested, right? He'd been building on some problems that were there, things that were not not just false images. But I think that sense that he was planning for people was what really got to her. And she famously called all of the planners in these camps, all of the different modern camps, right? The radiant garden city beautiful, right? This is how she described Lincoln Center, right? And she said this is, and she just sort of mashed them together. And I think that's what got to Mumford, right? Yeah. Being mashed together with the city beautiful, which he found too precious, or with the modernists, who he found too sort of technocratic, right? And not nearly organic enough, right? Mm-hmm. And so he wanted to see himself split apart from all these other reformers. And she said, that's ridiculous. It all goes together. We should shove it all off the table.
Right. And if you want to drive an architect insane, read to them the passage where she says, a city cannot be a work of art.
Right.
I interviewed a few architects for the film, and they all went right to that passage. And they said, it's the only thing italicized in the entire book. And I would like to explain why it can be. And she's saying... and actually, I came to the movie, I think Robert did as well, where it was huge fans of modernism. I mean, that's what I'm interested in. So the movie, in a way, forced us to argue the other side, because she really takes the other side, saying that, whoa, enough of these monuments to your ego, architect. Really, how about some retail? And why don't you build up to the street line? And all these things that were happening for very complicated reasons at the time that were eliminating retail store, and really what we would call user friendliness in cities were factored out because of a lot of egotistical theories, which, by the way, it's remarkable to me how women are still underrepresented in urban planning and architecture, and how the Corbusian ideas are still taught and passed down as these reverential things, like, you know, they're brought in the Ark of the Covenant and everyone's supposed to cower in front of them, yet the GSD and places like that. I think she was she went back to Harvard for another symposium, and someone got up, I think it was Sert, the architect who was head of the GSD at the time, and gave a big theory about how they were going to fix a lot of the urban renewal problems, and she just cut him dead by saying, oh great, that's just what we need, another big idea out of Harvard.
Right. One of the things that we discovered, my co-editor and I, Nathan Storing, and it's really this, the credit really goes to him in thinking about this, is the ways that Jacobs is, in some sense, we think of her as an anti-modernist, but in a way she's straight out of that generation. And she is, in some sense, a modernist. She not only believed in those ideas early on, but there's a way that she is actually asking people to follow the modernist dictum, the famous form follows function dictum, further than they would follow it. And she suggested that the problem was that everyone kept applying that only to buildings. If you applied that to cities, you would then probably need to go back and look and see the way cities really worked. And that, she said, was what she wanted to try to go out and do. And that, in some sense, makes her a kind of more modern than anyone else, right? As someone who really believes in the generative power of churning sort of human energies to be able to do things in cities and through cities, and cities as the modern form of human accomplishment. It just wasn't the cities that folks like that wanted to see built.
That's a nice point. She assails Corbusier and says that his vision of the city was like a great mechanical toy.
Yeah, right.
But what she sees the city as, and I think this is where she was visionary, she sees it as an organic system that self-organizes. And at the time, this was not really something that people wanted to pay much attention to because people were messy and could not be trusted to do these types of things themselves. And that's the side that she argued on. And I think this was, you could argue that this was visionary and that it came from someone who was someone that was an observer and independent thinker. And I think one of her great legacies, beyond the specifics of what she got right and got wrong and what she put out there, was this skepticism, what we call a healthy skepticism, that could sometimes be withering. But she she taught us, she teaches us that through death and life.
Can I ask a question? You know, I'd love to hear one of the things that I've, people have always asked me about, but you I feel I have a much better understanding, is how do you think of her approach to parks and open space? Because I think the superficial view is that she criticizes them or...
Because they're planned.
Yeah.
Well, she thought that they had the potential too easily to become dead space, right? And that they were too frequently thought of as a panacea that would solve problems in cities. Just throw some green space in there and everybody will have a place to, will believe they have a place to frolic, to recreate. They'll bring light and air. But all of those are sort of the modernist vision and continuing today to be part of the reason we believe in city parks. I think she made a bit of a, you know, she was, again, as we were saying, she could be withering. And I think in her judgments on parks tended to go too far on that sense. But what she wanted us to understand was not to think of parks as places apart, but to figure out the way that they should be part of the urban fabric around them, and not to be seen as places that that were entirely separate. She tells a great story in Death Life, of course, of the parks being the place that her kids always knew they'd get beat up. Right, the places they wouldn't get beat up is on the storefront and the street front in front of their, near their house or down the street around the corner, because there'd be lots of people around. The usual eyes on the street mode that she used. So yeah, I think that's my sense of that. I don't know. You know, there's more to it, I'm sure.
Another thing that's a bit dated about the book, and Robert and I went to visit her son in Toronto. She has two sons. One's kind of like number one son, who's the keeper of the flame, and he started apologizing to us about the pervert park section of the book. And I was like, why are you apologizing about the pervert park? You kept going on. It's like this whole thing about the pervert park. I promise you, she didn't mean it. I was thinking,
she
what is he
gays.
Talking about? I was like, I thought when the whole pervert park thing, I was thinking of like the old man flasher. That's what I was thinking of. The pervert park meant something very different, I suppose. It was a gay cruising park, right. I suppose. And she was right. She writes somewhat harshly about that. And he was saying, well, he was trying to grapple with that. But so there are certain things of there. She was of her era, I think, and we would probably not write about these things in quite that way these days. Yeah.
I have a feeling there are going to be a lot of questions tonight, so I think we should open the floor. Yes, sir. Madam.
But we're faced with a completely different landscape now, in which you know, we're bursting at the seams. We have no place for people to go, and yes, we all know that the housing projects that were built around New York are terrible, and all that stuff. But you know, can you extrapolate out from some of this stuff that you've been talking about how some places in Brooklyn, for instance, which is woefully underdeveloped, might be developed in this model of ground up, and user friendly, and all that other stuff, without the overlay of, you know, design as a solution?
You know, I think one of the things we looked at when we were first thinking about this movie is to find what is the answer, or what's a different way for China and India to develop, because they have very different needs than New York did there. They have to bring density. Cities are going to grow at a rate that they were not, you know, they were shrinking. They're going to have to grow at an exponential rate. So one of the things we looked at is let's find an example of sort of the positive, because you don't want to do the movie that's all doom and gloom. And what I think we found was we found a lot of people doing small things. But when you put that next to the problem, it didn't answer it. And I think the answer is going to be thousands of small answers. And I think that's what she would have want, is is people dealing with it on their own. And I think it, in some ways it's having the cities or the people at the top step back a little bit and let that messiness work out. And that's where the two countries that we looked at, China and India, you know, China has, I mean, India has much more hope because of its messiness, because it's actually harder to get things through. It's harder, whereas in China, it's very easy for them to demolish whole neighborhoods. And India is trying, but because of that messy democracy, it's harder. And so I think there's more hopes, you know, and looking at the slums for some of the answers of how they have self-organized.
But, you know, it's worth saying, even in New York, we have, you know, some would argue more democracy than people are comfortable with, because you have you can't just build, you know, a high-rise where a developer or the mayor wants to. You have community boards who, you know, communities have a huge say, which is, of course, a Jacob's legacy. You know, communities, neighborhoods should decide their fate. And there's this constant tension because you have... You know, nobody wants their own real estate values to go down with more high rises, but we're not going to solve the problem of housing people without building up in a city like this. Yeah. There just isn't land, unless you're going to just say, well, you know, poor people and wealthier people shouldn't live together. We'll just put everybody in Eastern Queens where there are no subways. There's plenty of land there and do that. Who wants to live in that city? You know, I don't. Yes.
Look like they have a say, and in many communities they do have a voice, but in other communities they don't. And that, like, for instance, the 197A plan is kind of a sham. Communities are asked to participate and do these plans. They are go through the city process, go through the UA process, and then they are dismissed completely, and huge rezonings take place, like in Greenpoint, Williamsburg.
Right.
So I think, you know, going back to what you said in the beginning, kind of, you were a little provocative about, I'm just trying to get my thoughts together. I'm not a very good public speaker. But the idea that if Jane Jacobs were alive today,
right,
I think she would be outraged at the city giveaways, the rezonings, the things that are done for big developers in the city and has changed the face of the city. And I think, you know, that's where we come back to, if we were doing it her way, you know, things might not have changed in such a big economic way that we have so many wealthy people living in high-rise apartments in our city and developers making a shitload of money.
Yes. And then...
We don't have to go to India or China to find what is going on. We just have to go down the street. It's a community board. There's the meetings, there are protests. The little library down the street is giving way to big money. So big democracy, big talk, and yet the neighborhood and the community doesn't seem to have a voice, because they've put all the signs around the little library that's going to go down, and a huge tower is going to come up. And who's going to rent in all these towers we see around here, where everything is prohibitive? How are you going to get at what you were talking about, Matt and the other gentleman? A collusion with big money and politics. We have it right here in this corner. So it's very despairing when we talk about coming from the ground up, and you feel that the big money and the politics are always going to win, because there they are. The little library has been cordoned off. It's going to go up no matter what you do.
Can I yeah, it's a great point. There's something that, when we were trying to tell the story in the movie, I wanted to make the movie for a general audience, because I thought preaching to the converted, a bunch of grad students in planning school, would be a fruitless task. So we make some dramatic moments between Jacobs and Moses, and you know, it wasn't all Robert Moses versus Jane Jacobs back then, but that's the story we tell. But you see, we go rather in depth into what she did in the West Village to help strategize to save Washington Square Park from being bisected by a highway, to stop Lomex, the Lower Manhattan Expressway, which was supposed to route through Soho and Chinatown and Little Italy, and also save the West Village from an urban renewal plan. A lot of it came down to pressure, and she was the grand strategist that figured out how to defuse the plans of the bureaucracy. But what it took, and this is the thing, is it took mind-numbing dedication and research and really, really good strategy, not depending on hearsay, but she really got in there and had a deep understanding and then tried all these tactics, which the movie lays out. So one of my hopes for the film is that pressure really does work. We're seeing that over now almost 40 days of protests. I think we're going to have to gear up for a lot of this across the board in ways that we never dreamt we would in this modern era. But in terms of fighting for your own community, I think you really can take lessons from her as a strategist. And it's really numbingly hard work, though. And the movie shows you exactly the lengths that she went. She sued Mayor Wagner. She filed a lawsuit against him personally. I mean, how many of us are willing to sue the mayor personally? maybe that's not what it takes. But pressure works. But also NIMBYism. Is another issue that we don't need to get into here, but like a lot of people misinterpret Jane as the goddess of NIMBY,
right.
And I'm not sure that she necessarily was that or would approve of that either, but because NIMBYism then goes off in directions that maybe become counterproductive.
The problem with that is that we have to think of, the historian will say we have to think of this historically, right? And that's what I do. And so I'm a little bit worried about commenting on current situations that I'm not entirely familiar with, but it does seem to me that Jacobs was fiercely determined to and dedicated to saying no, 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 no all the time, and that's why we think of her as a NIMBY. She said no. That was her strategy. Continue to always say no to any of these projects you think are bad. Never give anything away. Always stick to that. In her back pocket, especially in the West Village, they always had another plan for an alternative housing plan, and it got built eventually, the West Village houses. Which was a sort of middle-income way to do some infill housing for mixed-income folks, and that's it, which was a modest success. I think, in a way, what we have is such a strange and odd legacy of Jacobs's time, which is that we've preserved some of the things that come out of her time. We've preserved her commitment to saying no, 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 no about these kinds of the NIMBYist model, which we seem to need to continue to have, because we've also preserved the structure of incentives laid out in the urban renewal era, which incentivizes certain forms of private development, those that you feel here plaguing this neighborhood and many others. What we needed is what she was really asking for, which was incentivizing forms of development from the bottom up and not giving incentives just simply to private developers with a lot of money to make this kind of development, but to give communities an ability to try to be more than reactive and to be proactive and to try to do things for communities. Now, the problem with that is that in that era, it was an era of suburbanization, and most people with money wanted to leave the city. Now that many people with money want to be in cities, they want to protect those property values. So you have a kind of opposite problem, and you need to find a way to incentivize it so that people with money will find ways to believe in the virtues that Jane Jacobs practiced and preached, which was people living together in diverse and dense communities. And we need to incentivize that in the political economic sphere. And that's really what I think she stood for.
The dichotomy between Jane and Robert Moses was Jane was focused on walking and public transportation. Robert Moses was building the New York Expressway. In fact, they have parks named after him. And especially, so I'd like you to comment on that. And then the second part is you talked about the things that are going on in China and India right now. China's building hundreds of miles of high-speed rail and light rail systems and subway systems. And what did we build last year? Nada. Same thing with India. So I think this is one of the key parts, transportation as a way of moving people around, and I'd like you to address those topics.
Well, it's covered in the film.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And also in The Power Broker, there's like feverish chapter about the decision not to build light rail down the center of the LIE, which was the original plan. And Moses did everything he could to stop that, one, and defund the subways. And he was, you know, this was one of the heights of his misguidedness in the latter part of his career. Jacobs was certainly for that. I mean, the idea of having public transportation accessible by foot to make a functional city is the key. And the automobile industry did everything in their power to undo that theory. And Robert Moses in 1939 was the winner of the General Motors essay contest, where he wrote an essay about the need for highways. So that talk about collusion. I mean, that's the other kind of collusion we didn't talk about. And of course, there's the very famous story. I'm born and raised in Los Angeles, and now live in Los Angeles after having lived in New York for years. LA is vilified in Death and Life, somewhat unfairly. I think it's a really interesting city, and lots of interesting things are really happening now, but it was the poster child because Firestone Tires and other companies colluded to destroy the best streetcar system in the country after World War II. So we all know that story. It's absolutely essential to the pickle that we're in right now. China, I'm not an expert on China. We shot there and we focused on urban villages. However, we spoke to an expert, Peter Calthorpe out of Berkeley, who's a really great urban studies guy, and he told us that the Chinese government has listened to a lot of experts they brought in, and there is a whole new transportation model to all new developments have to have certain access to public transportation, which should eliminate automobile traffic by a certain amount of percent. They seem to be getting religion in some form, according to him. California has stopped the building of freeways. It's now prohibited to build freeways, and light rail is mandated. So there are small glimmers of hope. And the subway opened here last year. So it only took 100 years to build.
But a lot of people would argue it's Jane that's made it harder for us to build big infrastructure, big new infrastructure projects like subways and trains.
Right. You can say
that was the pendulum swinging too far effect. Right. I don't know. Do you have any insight into that? I mean,
I'll leave that there.
There's a very provocative essay out there that you can all read that says that she caused the pendulum to swing way too far, and it has held us back.
Hi. I have a non-public policy question, more about Jane the person. I got interested in Jane's philosophical writings back in the 90s. I remember coming here. She spoke at the library in 2000, which I think was in New York Public, I think shortly before she died. My question, I never read a biography of Jane. I don't even know if there is one.
Yes, or,
there are some.
Okay.
Just this
recently,
year.
Recently, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Really? Okay. I didn't know that. I don't know that much about her. But I know that she made this abrupt move to Toronto, you know, not as an elderly person, but I think, you know, later middle age, I don't know all the circumstances. I know she continued to be productive and wrote books and all. I'm intrigued that she was trying to encourage, you know, this kind of bottom-up development stuff going on there, I presume as a private citizen. I just wanted to ask the very knowledgeable panel here, very briefly, if, you know, about that stage of her life. Was she productive in Toronto? I always had the feeling that it was a little bit of a withdrawal after getting so famous here in New York.
But no,
she moved, the opposite. She moved because to have her son avoid the draft.
Which her son denies that claim.
And the most interesting thing, as we were talking about earlier, is that she has two of her children are total back to the land, anti-urban. I mean,
I think three.
I think that go Freudian on that for a long time. But
well, they were going to build, when she moved to Toronto, she moved to a neighborhood, and they were going to build the Spadina Expressway through her neighborhood, which then she helped stop. But then she was really embraced by Toronto and actually then worked with the next mayor on his urban development plan. So she actually had, I mean, did she live most of her life in Toronto?
Almost half of her life.
She moved there in 67.
But so. Wrote most of her books there.
Most of her writing. Yeah.
And was much more embraced and much more well-known in Toronto.
She was a sort of minor celebrity in Canada and in Toronto generally. She was much more embraced there by the official kind of government, public policy folks there, mayors, even up to the provincial level and to the national level. So she, and that's in part because she arrived there at a time when there was the progressive ideas about urban planning were starting to filter through. They weren't entirely there, right? As Robert said, she had to join a campaign to stop the Spadina Expressway. But there were people who came through after that who were interested in her ideas. And she's a kind of backroom, behind the scenes influence on a bunch of sort of more progressive styles of bottom-up urbanist redevelopment that went on, particularly in Toronto, in the 60s, 70s, and up into the 80s and 90s.
We're leaving out a big dramatic beat here, though, but she was charged with three felonies for disrupting a public meeting. It's called Stenogate, in retrospect, here in New York, where she, they were Lower Manhattan Expressway board meeting, and she organized a protest to rush the stage, and the stenographer clutched her steno machine, and the tape fell out and ran across the stage, and then there was sort of like a Dadaist thing with the tape, and then Jacobs stood up and said, if there's no record of the meeting didn't happen. at which point she was arrested. And charged with three felonies, and those were not resolved, and partly the reason that she decided to get out of town, actually. And she had trouble with immigration, in fact, because she was a suspected felon, I suppose.
The story about how she left the United States is quite dramatic if you read Robert Canigal's biography. They left without telling anybody. They just planted it amongst their family. They got in their minibus one day and drove to Canada.
Right.
And relocated to Toronto on a whim, and then they called their entire family and told them, we've left, we now live in Toronto, we've emigrated, we're not, you should not think of us as expatriates, we're immigrants, we've left. And it was at a very consequential time. There was a wedding that was about to happen in the family. They told them all their family members they were going to be at the wedding. When they didn't show up, nobody knew what was going on. It was very dramatic.
My favorite Toronto personal detail is that she needed a housekeeper. She had this beloved housekeeper in New York, and she got her housekeeper through Marshall McLuhan, as one does when one moves to Canada. Anyone else?
I think we have, one more question.
One more.
This will be the last.
Could you point out? It's right there.
I can speak loudly. What do you think Jane Jacobs would have done with a Hurricane Sandy type of?
Well, I mean.
What do you think she would have advocated? What do you think she would have recommended? And that's a very.
Did you? What would Jane Jacobs have advocated or recommended post-Hurricane Sandy or something along those lines?
A disaster. Right.
That big, yeah.
Well, I mean, a lot of what happened after Sandy is you saw incredible grassroots volunteerism, right, which she certainly would have championed. I rebuilding-wise, I'll leave it.
I hate to speculate about Jane. I feel like there'll be lightning bolts.
The what would Jane do thing is difficult. I feel comfortable sometimes talking about what she did.
Right.
It's hard to say what she did.
And also,
but I do think she would, you know, one of the great lessons for us of her writing and her thinking rather than what she did was that that we need to be in conversation and in action together with each other across all kinds of social divisions to make choices and decisions about those things.
But it's a tough thing to imagine, too, because it crossed so many different communities. I mean, it was New Jersey was devastated, Long Island, parts of the city, and it did all kinds of different populations.
Yeah.
Well, it would have been further proof that housing projects are a terrible idea because, of course, they were built on the water where the land was cheap in the 30s, and so many people who suffered, you know, lived in public housing.
Right.
So, okay. Well, thank you so much for coming. Come back.
Thank you.